Turn in your Bibles, please, to Mark chapter 5. As we're making our way through this study of Mark, this amazing gospel story, this what we believe to be the story that Peter told of the life of Jesus and copied down by Mark and then shared with us, this gospel in action. So I've told you before, Mark goes to great pains to move Jesus toward the cross. Then, next, quickly, immediately, he uses these words to move the narrative on. We find ourselves now, having studied last week about the powerful event where Jesus was on the boat and the storm came up and he was sleeping in the storm. The disciples panicked and he rose and spoke to the sea and said, "Be muzzled," literally is what he said. And the sea calmed. And the disciples who'd been with him now for a little while, seen the miracles where he healed this one and touched this one. Even the study today, the encounter with the demoniac, Mark records that in the first chapter, a different encounter. And they said, in the face of this, the sea calming immediately, "Who is this man?" And I told you last week, it's the question we ought to be able to ask and answer and then ask others, who is Jesus? And pray that our witness and our prayers for them would bring them to the point where they would say, "He is Christ, the Son of the living God." So today in Mark chapter 5, I'm going to read verses 1 to 20 as we look at this episode from demoniac to disciple. As I was studying this past week, I was reminded that the second sermon I ever preached in 1973 was on this passage entitled "From Madman to Missionary." That's what you see happening here today. So Mark chapter 5, verses 1 to 20, we have the text for you if you don't have your own Bible, but I much prefer if you look at it in your own Bible. And stand with me, if you would, while I read this passage. As we read this together, and look, I want you to know some things. I want you to feel some things, and I hope we can evoke some action from that. I want you to know that Jesus assigns great value to even the most wretched and sin-sick soul. And I want you to feel, as we encounter this, the amazing love that Jesus has for you, no matter how great your sin might be, might have been. And I want you then to act. I want you to respond to this by loving those sinners who seem to be the most defiant and destructive, and consider how the gospel can totally transform them, as it has you and me. Mark chapter 5. Beginning in verse 1. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. And when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. He lived among the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been bound with shackles and chains. But he wrenched the chains apart. He broke the shackles in pieces. No one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. When he saw Jesus from afar off, he ran and fell down before him. Crying out with a loud voice, he said, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me." For he, that is Jesus, was saying to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." And Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" And he replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he begged him earnestly not to send them out of the country. Now a great herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside. And they begged him, saying, "Send us to the pigs, let us enter them." So he gave them permission. And the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs, and the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned in the sea. The herdsmen fled and told it in the city and in the country. And people came to see what it was that had happened. And they came to see Jesus. They came to Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had had the legion, sitting there, clothed in his right mind. Glory. Oh, mercy. And they were afraid. And those who had seen it described to them what had happened to the demon-possessed man and to the pigs. And they began to beg Jesus to depart from their region. As he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with demons begged him that he might be with him. And he did not permit him, but said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." And he went away, began to proclaim in the Decapolis, that is this region of 10 cities, how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone marveled. What have we just read? The inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient Word of God. Oh God, teach us from this text today with renewed joy and excitement that Jesus loves me. And then help us to see others through this text and be hopeful for the power, the powerful demonstration of the saving work of Jesus shown to them. Thank you. Be seated. Well, they've just gotten off the boat. The story they had to tell. The waves were crashing over the boat. These fishermen, I told you last week, these fishermen knew what it was to be out in a storm. But this storm was so bad that fishermen began to cry out in anguish. Now they're stepping on dry ground, a calm sea behind them. What a great backdrop that is for what's going to happen next in the ministry of Jesus. I want you to look at this text with me today under four considerations. First of all, Jesus encounters a demon-possessed man. Then second, Jesus shows his authority over the demons. Third, the response of the people to Jesus' power. Fourth, the response of the new disciple to the power of Jesus as well. Let's look at these things. He encounters this demon-possessed man as they go on the other side of the sea, the country of the Gerasenes. It will read in some other translations, perhaps the Gadarenes. There's some question as to whether it was called Gerasa or Gadara. But the Gerasenes, that seems to be the right rendering of it. He steps out of the boat and immediately, there's one of Mark's favorite words, immediately, there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. The tombs in Jesus' day were, as you would imagine, outside, typically outside the city for various reasons. They were typically carved into the side of a hill. This man with this unclean spirit, this man who was demon-possessed. And there was demon possession then, and there is demon possession now. However, take heart, a true follower of Jesus Christ cannot be demon possessed. We can give in to his influences and cause our witness to be harmed. We can surrender ground to him. We can unwittingly follow him. We can be ignorant of his schemes. But if we have the Spirit of the living God living in us, then there is no space for the demonic to live in us. This man's demon-possessed. He sees Jesus. One commentator said, one wonders with the hill where these tombs probably were, he was able to see Jesus step out of the boat. One wonders if he saw the storm suddenly go away. No one could bind this man. Look at the pitiful condition of this man. Their remedy for his malady was to put chains around him. And yet, when you find out, when he tells his name as Legion, we know that a Roman legion had 6,000 soldiers in it. Not so much to say that he had 6,000 demons, but that he was inhabited by a large number of demons. And one of the ways the demonic manifested itself was a superhuman strength to break any bindings that might be put upon him. And so the people just give up. I think one of the other gospel writers says, and the people were afraid to travel that way, because they never know when they might encounter him. It says he'd often been bound, in verse 4, with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart, broke the shackles in pieces. No one had the strength to subdue him. So now, all the religious leaders, all the military leaders in this mixed district, this 10 cities of Jews and Gentiles living there, Jewish religious leaders, Roman soldiers, no one had the strength to subdue him. It's a mercy that they hadn't killed him. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. He was not only a danger to others, as they imagined, he was a danger to himself. He would self-inflicted wounds. And you can imagine, if he was cutting himself with stones, the pain of that, the lack of the sanitary context of that. And he, there he was, showing, I think, a visible, tangible evidence. When Jesus says in John 10:10, the thief, speaking of the devil, comes but to kill, steal, and destroy. Here's a man who seems bent on self-destruction. When Jesus saw him, when he saw Jesus from far off, he ran to him. Now put yourselves there. I get alarmed if a Rottweiler, I don't know, runs toward me, you know? But a man who had to look, a crazed look in his eyes, no doubt. And the way he must have looked physically, racing toward them. Again, it's a mercy that Peter didn't draw his sword and take him out. As he runs toward him, he begins to cry out with a loud voice, "What do you have to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" It's very fascinating. I've told you before that throughout the Gospels, the demons always know who he is. The Pharisees are blind as bats. The demons always know who he is. In fact, James says in his book, chiding people who would say, "I have faith." He says, "You have faith? That's nice." He says, "Even the demons have faith in that way and tremble." "I plead with you," he says, "by God, do not torment me." Now, that to me is an amazingly ironic statement. Here's a man who is in incredible torment. And so this demonic influence in him, this demonic habitation of him, who terrorizes this man day and night and terrorizes a community so that they won't even come around him, "Please, don't torment me. Don't do to us what we're so glad to do to any son of man, any daughter of Eve." So there he is. What a specimen. You have to ask yourself, if you were standing there with the disciples, would you pity him or would you fear him? Be honest. Would you be saying to yourself, "He'd make a great traveling companion. Maybe Jesus will call him to follow him"? Or would you be fearful? I'd probably be fearful initially. So here's what's happening. As this man is running to Jesus, and crying out, "Jesus, Son of the Most High God," testifying to something that even the 12 following Jesus could not formulate adequately at this point in the journey. The second thing I want you to see is that Jesus shows his authority over the demons, because we're told in the next verses, Jesus was saying to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit. Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." Now, we could wonder, well, why everywhere else we see it when Jesus speaks or looks or it happens. In this case, Jesus he's exhorting and admonishing and rebuking. He just has not applied the power yet. And it's interesting, some of the writers say that for this demonic man to call his name Jesus, that there was a belief in that day that if you knew someone's name, you could take power over them. That if you were an evil spirit, you could take power over them. And even to this day, there's people that teach on demonology. Some are good, some are not so good, who will say that if you know the demon's name, you can take authority over him. Well, that's being practiced here. And whatever all those implications were, this much we know. He says, "Jesus, what do you..." And it doesn't faze Jesus. This demon has no authority over him. And what Jesus does next is very interesting. Because Jesus knows all things. "What is your name?" Jesus responded. "My name is Legion, for we are many." And I just wonder what that sounded like. A man that lives shrieking in pain and shrieking in agony. And no doubt, demonically possessed, shrieking with delight sometimes. What that sounded like. "My name is Legion, for we are many." Now Jesus has his name. And at that moment, this demonically possessed man, and you get the picture almost as if he's maybe moving in and out of consciousness. And the demons have such a hold on him. Verse 10, he begged Jesus earnestly not to send them out of the country. In other words, not to disinhabit them. Not to simply remove them from this man, which tells us that they knew he could. Isn't it fascinating? The religious leaders would question the miracles. These demons know something of the capability of Jesus. They knew he could. And we're told that there was this great herd of pigs feeding on the hillside. And you read through different commentators, and there's the observation that this is a Gentile and Jewish region. They're mixed. That it would have been wrong for Jews to raise pigs, because Jews are forbidden to eat pigs under that Jewish dietary prohibition. So you don't know. Were these folks that were herding the pigs, were they Jews? If so, that's quite a dilemma, a hypocritical dilemma. Or Gentiles, they're about to see their stock go way down. And they begged Jesus in verse 12, saying, "Send us to the pigs. Let us enter them." Now, we know what's going to happen next. We just read the text. So when they made that request, the request was not with the intent of being destroyed after that. It was with the intent of now having another animate object to indwell and run around. And I honestly don't know what 2,000 demon-possessed pigs would look like if you had to deal with that for a while. I mean, pigs are pretty obnoxious on their own. Like a demon-possessed pig is almost being redundant, isn't it? But Jesus grants it. "Send us to the pigs. Let us enter them." They did not anticipate what was going to happen. So he gave them permission, verse 13, and the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs. And the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned in the sea. So Jesus' plan and purpose and determination to destroy these demons was, if anything, only delayed. It was not avoided, just delayed. So I want you to see the third thing, the response of the people to Jesus' power. The herdsmen left in verse 14, and they told it in the city and in the country, and the people came to see what it was that had happened. And I'd love to have heard that story being told. How they would have described it. There are things they would not have known, but what they did know was that the pigs that they were watching and herding and had done this on several occasions, suddenly, all at once, stampeded into the water, totally counterintuitive, contrary to the nature of a pig. So verse 15, they came to Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had had the legion, sitting there. There's no indication in the text that this man ever sits down. He runs, roams, probably until he just passes out. And then when he comes to again, he's more of the same. Sitting there, clothed. Couldn't keep chains on him, couldn't keep clothes on him. Clothed in his right mind. And you would think at this point the text would say, and they rejoiced to see the power of God among them. But that's not what the text says, does it? And they were afraid. They were terrified. Isn't it really interesting how people are? I mean, we're a strange lot. When the Lord does demonstrate power, even among people who profess to believe in Christ and believe he's powerful, well, sometimes the initial response is one of doubt, wonder. Is that really what's happened here? The people were terrified. And while you and I would like to think that they would say to him, Rabbi, come with us into the town. We have people there that need help. That's not what they said. Those who had seen it described to them what had happened to the demon-possessed man and to the pigs, and they began to beg Jesus to depart from their region. Leave us. Peter did the same thing on the miraculous catch of fish earlier on in Mark, where they'd fished all night, and Jesus said, set your boats out. And Peter said, Rabbi, we're fishermen. We know what we're doing. We fished all night. We caught nothing. He said, well, okay, because you say so, we will. And they go out, and the boat begins to sink with all the fish they catch in the net. And Peter's response is, depart from me. I am a wicked man. I don't know who you are, but you're too holy to be in my presence. That's a different kind of departure. These guys want him out of the region because Jesus has proved bad for business. And there it is right there. You see one of the glaring indictments of mankind, that too often we value coins more than we do a soul. There's more joy in heaven when one sinner repents. And too often today, we're okay when sinners repent as long as it doesn't cost us anything. They beg Jesus, depart from our region. Here's the contrast, beautiful contrast. And the fourth thing, the response of the new disciple. In verse 18, as he was getting in the boat, Jesus obliges them, by the way. He's just stepped off the boat. They haven't been there long at all. They had the opportunity to have the Messiah, this rabbi, come into their area and minister among them, teaching them. He hasn't been there long at all, and he turns and gets back into the boat. It is the equivalent of what Jesus told his disciples when he sent them out two by two. If a town will not receive you, shake the dust off your feet and walk away. That's exactly what he does here. And this precious young disciple, what does he know? What questions could he answer about theology and about the intricacies of the gospel and the promises of the coming Messiah? What could this fellow say? Here's all he could say, basically. This Jesus, who seems to be the Son of the Most High God, delivered me. My chains are gone. My heart is free. He rose and wanted to follow Jesus wherever Jesus was going. That is the heart of a disciple. It's right there. Jesus was getting in the boat, verse 18, the man who'd been possessed with demons begged him that he might be with him. Isn't it interesting? The townspeople begged him to leave. The disciple begs him, let me go with you. Let me follow you. And in an interesting turn of things, because Jesus does not always do this, oftentimes when he performs a miracle in Mark, he says, tell no one. This man, however, Jesus not only has loosed him from his bondage to sin, his bondage to the demons, and his broken body and broken mind, not only has he loosed him and delivered him from that. Verse 19 says, he did not permit him to, but said to him, go home to your friends. You have to wonder who they were. How long had it been since this man had had friends, companions? But he did it. Go home and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you. What do you call, how do you describe what just happened? Jesus, the Son of the Most High, had mercy on him. The very thing that the blind Bartimaeus will cry out on the side of the road later on, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Go tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he's had mercy on you. And he went away. He didn't object, didn't protest, didn't express disappointment. He went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him. And everyone marveled. And later on in the Gospels, when Jesus comes back through this district, you know what happens? They empty their towns, bringing their sick to him. This man was faithful. And what could he say? Jesus, the Son of the Most High God, delivered me. I'm not who I was. I'm a new person. Now, brothers and sisters, I think sometimes we will look at the fact that Jesus had the disciples with him for three and a half years, depending on how the chronology breaks down. And we say, well, we need to study that. This man knew Jesus for probably 5 minutes. And it was enough for him to go. It's much like the woman at the well. She goes back after a brief encounter with Jesus, says, I have met a man who told me everything I've ever done. He read my mind. He looked deep into me. It's amazing in the scripture. You don't find a disciple, a newly made disciple, who gets over it, number one. And you don't find a disciple who decides it's his or her responsibility to simply contemplate what Jesus has done. Even the ones where he says, tell no one. I've always wondered about this. Is it okay to disobey Jesus? If Jesus says, tell no one, and you go out and they go and tell the good news, they can't help but tell what they've seen and heard. I don't know how all that works out. But it's one of the marks of a disciple. And I wonder sometimes if people think back to your conversion. Were you excited? Were you sort of in with newfound faith, almost in disbelief that someone would love you that much? And then you get into the flow of churchianity in the West, in America, and it begins to dull the edges of that newfound excitement. And no, nobody here was in this man's condition physically. I don't imagine, like Josh said, I doubt any of us have ever been in chains for very long. Maybe briefly handcuffed by the authorities not long-term chains, you know. But you know something? Whether you were saved at 5 or 75, you were set free. The difference is that a 5-year-old would probably not have amassed the bondage that someone in adulthood would and could. This man went from demoniac to disciple in a matter of a few minutes. And didn't ask Jesus to recommend a good seminary to him so he could go study more about him. Didn't go to the rabbis and say, you know, I'm the guy you heard about, that's the crazy guy by the tombs. I'm him. Can I enroll and study? He didn't do that. He just went and told how much the Lord has done for him. He went and told about the marvelous, miraculous manifestation of mercy that had been shown to him. And brothers and sisters, that's all we're asked to do. What has the Lord done for you? What did he bring you out of? I've told you before, I was raised in a really interesting home, a godly mother and an incredibly hypocritical father. My godly mother kept pointing me to Jesus and praying for me and weeping over my soul, and as I hit my teens. And I was religious, but I was a hypocrite. And then the Lord, sure enough, broke in and saved me. Saved me from my dead religiosity. I owe much to him, because I could have gone down the path of the fellow who could pray in church, could give, could work around the building, could go on outreach, could teach a Sunday school class. That was my dad, and still not be saved. What did he deliver you from? You say, well, it really wasn't much, preacher. I was pretty much doing okay, and he kind of gave me the little boost I needed. Well, no, religion gives you the boost you need. Jesus Christ transforms you and then releases you. And what Peter and John said when they threatened to beat them in the book of Acts if they didn't stop talking about this man Jesus, what they said was, do what seems best to you. But we have to do what seems best to us, and we cannot help but speak of that which we've seen and heard. We cannot help but tell what the Lord has done for us and how his mercy has been shown to us. So I'd love to see in my life, in your life, this what we call primitive Christianity, where it didn't dawn on this man that he had to figure some things out before he could speak. He wasn't hindered by that. He wasn't hindered by people who took him aside and said, it's great that you've been saved, now we need to get you trained. He wasn't hindered by that. He just went like a man who'd been drowning and has the life raft tossed to him. And suddenly he comes up out of the water, and the water comes out of his mouth, and he gasps for air. It's life. My prayer, starting with me as your pastor, but for you as well, is that we would recover something of this primitive Christianity and be like this precious older pastor I met several years ago in Oklahoma City, who said, you know, he said, I try to share Jesus with people I meet, and said, they'll say to me, well, what about this and this and this in the Bible? And he says, I don't know all about that. What I do know is that God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. He says, well, somebody says, well, what about this controversy, this question about whether or not this passage agrees with this passage, and what about all the terrible things Christians have done? And he says, I don't know a whole lot about that. What I do know is that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. When the blind man was healed in John 9 and the Jewish authorities brought him before them, tell us about this man. What did he do? He said, all I know is I was blind. And now I see. And Jesus said to him when he touched his eyes, he said, do you in the Son of God? He said, Lord, if you show him to me, I will. I'll believe anything you say. And Jesus said, you're looking at him. The eyes that couldn't see, you're looking at him. That's all he needed. And finally, the man in John 9 gets a little miffed. His parents have thrown him under the bus. They won't have anything to do with him. And the religious leaders keep pressing and pressing. He says, why are you so curious? Do you want to become one of his disciples too? Maybe your story is not from demoniac to disciple, but it's from something to disciple. Jesus loves you. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ here today, he has proven infallibly his love for you by dying on the cross, rising from the grave, giving you the gospel in one way, shape, or form. But if you're not yet a follower of Jesus Christ here today, he is willing to show his love to you. He will show his love to all who repent of their sins and trust, just simple, childlike trust and faith in him, and say, I want to be able to say, Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus is for me. If you can say that today, and his word to you is, go to your friends, your family, and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you. Tell them how his mercy has been shown to you. That's really how you boil down the Christian life, isn't it? You testify of who Jesus is, what he came to do, and how that has made a transforming difference in your life. It's my prayer for you today. Let's pray.